In class, we talked about terrestrial locomotion, but I ran out of time to show you some videos. So as you recall, some of the things that people study when we study locomotion is how they increase speed. And they can do that by either changing their kinematics, increasing how quickly they cycle their limbs, and that would increase stride frequency. Or you could also increase your stride length, which is how far you travel in each limb cycle. Or you can change your dynamics or your biomechanics. You can actually exert more force by pushing harder. And you can also bring your limbs more in line with the force vectors so that the animal has a more upright posture. And then they'll get more out of the force they generate because they're pointing more in the direction of motion. So when we study locomotion, we do usually look at different gaits. And here is a running iguana video. It's very slow because it's filmed at 250 frames per second, but played back at 30 frames per second. And this was some video taken in my lab many years ago. And you can look at the motions and look at the angles of the joints. You can also measure the ground reaction forces on a force plate. And then what you can do is actually model each joint. And from the ground reaction force, you can recreate how much force should be operating on the hip joint and the knee joint. Okay, so these are some gaits. And basal tetrapods such as lizards can trot. And so trotting is a diagonally opposite gait, and this is a quadrupedal trot when the animal is running with all four limbs. And you can see that it's a beautiful running lizard. This is a desert lizard taken by my friend Duncan Urshick when he was in Bruce Jane's lab as a postdoc. And so you can see that running has an aerial phase. So there's always a time when there's a time during the limb cycle when all the limbs are off the ground. A lot of animals, when they go really fast, they go bipedal. So this is a bipedal trot. And this is pretty similar to how we ourselves would trot, except, of course, we're not going to be leaning forward so much because we don't have this big long tail to balance us out. So only crocodiles and mammals can gallop. And you can see galloping is a pretty rapid gait here where they sort of bound from the forelimbs to the hind limbs. And although you might think that crocodiles are basically big lazy lizards, they in fact are archosaurs and have some pretty interesting adaptations. So we looked at the running cheetah in class, and they're a pretty amazing, graceful animal. And one thing that people have noticed about cheetahs is that they have this incredibly flexible spine, and in fact, they hyperextend their spine, which is thought to increase their stride length even further. So these are some of the gait parameters that we talked about. The stride is one complete limb cycle. So for example, push off until that limb does the next push off. Step, it refers to the time when the limb is on the ground from toe down to toe up. And then duty factor is the step duration over the stride duration, or how long the foot is on the ground compared to the entire limb cycle. So usually, when an animal has a duty factor less than 0.5, that's considered running. Okay. So you can create gait diagrams, and this is a bipedal walk, quadrupedal walk, hexapedal walk, a trot, and a gallop. Okay. So quadrupedal, when animals are walking, and they're quadrupedal, they do tend to have a triangle of support. And then the difference between, so as they increase in speed, there's a transition to a trot, and that's when you have your diagonally opposite limbs on the ground at the same time with an aerial phase. So trotting is a running gait. And then as animals increase in speed even more, if they can, they'll transition to a gallop, in which the hind limbs are on the ground, and then the forelimbs are on the ground, and then the hind limbs are on the ground, and then the forelimbs are on the ground. So an interesting question that some people posed is, can elephants indeed run? Because as you know, they are incredibly heavy animals, and it was not really clear whether or not they would run, because perhaps it would cause too much stress on, especially on the forelimbs, which are the limbs that a running animal would land on. So just to see again, here is a walk. And so what these scientists did was they went and they measured walking and running in Asian elephants. And they measured about 133 elephants. They filmed them. They put markers on them at their hip, knee, and ankle joints. And then so walking was no problem at all. Here it is one more time. Okay, and then they tried their very best to make them run. And they chased them with noisemakers. And they did their best to make them run. So they found some really interesting things. When they measured their duty cycles on the limbs versus the Froude number, which is a dimensionless measure of speed, they found that even with increasing speed, there are basically several patterns of limb phase. And so some of the limbs were actually staying on the ground for a very short amount of time, which is much more similar to a running gait. Whereas other limbs were more sort of similar to a walking limb duty cycle. So this is really interesting. And then what they found when they measured the vertical displacement, like if they measure the joint center, how much does it go up and down? When they looked at the forelimbs, it went up and down quite a lot, actually much more reminiscent of walking. However, when they looked at the hind limbs, the up and down motion was much, much smaller. So all of this information together sort of pointed to this story of the forelimbs doing walking and the hind limbs doing running. So this way they can actually move pretty darn fast. Like their maximum speed was about 6.8 meters per second, which is pretty fast. And they could reach duty factors of about 0.37, which is also really more like running. But they always had limbs on the ground. And they did this by having the front half of the body walking and the back half of the body running. Pretty cool, huh? So then there's some really weird stuff. Here's some really cool locomotor modes. Here is the basilisk running on water. And as you can see, what happens is the lizard slaps its foot on the surface of the water and then causes a cavitation. And before the bubble collapses and sticks to its foot, the foot is already out of the water again. So you can see it again here. Oops. Ah. Here it goes. See the bubble? And there it goes into the next limb cycle. Pretty amazing, huh? One more time. Whee! This is the only hopping bat. It's a vampire bat. And this is a really freaky mode of locomotion. And then, of course, there's frog jumping, which is done with its really unusual pelvis. It's very long and highly kinetic. There's a highly kinetic sacroiliac joint, which means that it can bend quite a lot. And there's pinnate muscles connecting the pelvis to the urostyle, the ilium to the urostyle. And when those muscles contract, it's storing force, which then can be released when the animal jumps. So when you study locomotion, probably acceleration is the least studied of all the parts of terrestrial locomotion. So it's important because acceleration is what an animal does when it starts from a stop and then it wants to move. And so the takeoff, the transition from being motionless to running, for example, is probably the most expensive part of the movement. There aren't any opportunities for elastic recoil, elastic storage and recovery, or any kinds of transfers of momentum or anything like that. It's all thrust. Furthermore, most animals run intermittently in nature. There's very few animals that actually just run at constant speed, even though constant speed is the most well-studied mode of locomotion. So it's probably under strong selection if animals have to escape for their lives or catch prey, but we know not so much about it. So one of the things that we've been studying is force production in lizards. And so lizards exert forces on the ground, and then the ground reacts with equal but opposite force. And we can measure this with a force plate. So X is the direction of motion or propulsive force, Y is lateral, and Z is the orthogonal normal force, the up and down force. So we've done force plate experiments with lizards running across the force plate. Okay. And then we analyzed the hind limb. And so we looked at the impulse, or the total force produced under a limb cycle. And you can measure this too. And in fact, you will in lab. So usually what people study is either the total force or impulse or the peak force. So we did an experiment where we actually measured force production in pregnant or gravid iguanas. We wanted to know who produced more force. The ones that were recovered, well recovered from reproduction, or the ones that were fully gravid. And of course, the ones that are fully gravid are producing way more force. But what was really weird and really surprising to us that was this weird pattern that we found with the early post-gravid. So right after they laid their eggs, they seem to have trouble generating force, and it's sort of going, more force produced doesn't result in greater acceleration, which is really, really weird, and which pointed to this possibility that perhaps they're really disrupted, too stretched out to be able to actually be effective. Okay, so you're gonna get a chance to do this in lab, and I hope you have some fun with it. Take care.